Good morning. Welcome to all of you to this Sunday service. We shall begin with a prayer. This prayer is from the Shiva Mahimna Stotram. Many of you are familiar with this. This hymn describing the glories of Lord Shiva was composed by a Gandharva. His name was Pushpadanta. From that hymn, one stanza will use for prayer this morning. Om Asita Giri Samam Syat Kajjalam Sindhu Patre Surataru Varashakha Lekani Patra Murvi Likati Yadi Grihitva Sharada Sarvakalam Tadapi Tava Gunanam Ishaparam Nayati Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. O Lord Shambhu, using the biggest branch of the celestial tree as the writing instrument, the ocean as the ink pot, and the blue mountain as the ink, and using the whole earth as the writing surface, if the goddess of learning Sharada were to write from now until end of eternity, even then, O Lord, thy glories cannot be fully described. Infinite indeed are thy glories. Om peace. May there be peace and joy in our hearts. May there be peace and harmony amongst all beings. May there be peace everywhere in nature. For the last 3 sessions, we have been studying the teachings of Sri Ramakrishna in 8 aphorisms. These aphorisms were composed by Swami Harshanandaji Maharaj, and he recently passed away, in the same style as Narada's aphorisms on devotion, Narada Bhakti Sutra. In these 8 aphorisms, Swami Harshanandaji has tried to capture the main principal teachings of Sri Ramakrishna in a very elegant way. We have been studying it for some time. So far we have studied out of 8, 5 aphorisms. For those who are joining now, I should quickly mention the 5 aphorisms we have studied so far. Then we shall continue with the 6th aphorism today. The first sutra is Ishvara asti eva sa eva satyam. Sri Ramakrishna said with emphasis, firm emphasis, that God does exist. And this he said not based upon a study of scriptures, from his own direct experience. Every moment, every day, he was in constant communion with the divine. Based on experience, he gave all these teachings. God definitely is. He alone is the truth. Saiva satyam. Everything else that we are seeing, the world and everything, it is true only in an empirical way. For some time, it appears to be true. Some people say it's like a dream. Dream is very true when you are experiencing it, but it dissolves when we wake up from dream. So this waking state is like that. So that was the first teaching. God does exist, no doubt about it. And then there is no equivocation When Narendra, later Swami Vivekananda, he asked him this question, famous question, have you seen God? Narendra had asked this question of many people before. They all were giving long talks about God, but none of them had said directly, yes, I have seen God. Here for the first time, Narendra's question was answered by Sri Ramakrishna without any doubt, equivocation, or no lecture. Yes, God, I have seen God. I am seeing God more vividly than I am seeing you. And you too can see God. That was the first aphorism. Second aphorism was, it is possible to see God for everybody. May not be at the same time, may not be quickly. It's possible. He says, the second aphorism is, tam drashtum jnatum tena saha alapam kartum cha sadhyam. It is definitely possible to see God, to realize God, experience God, and to have conversation with God as we are able to converse with each other with firmness. And he was doing that every day. Every time he could go and talk to Divine Mother. When Totapuri, the Advaitic teacher, monk, came to Dakshineshwar, he got down from the boat and he saw Sri Ramakrishna sitting on the steps of the river, absorbed in deep thought. Then Totapuri immediately recognized, this is the person who is fit to learn Advaita Vedanta. So Totapuri asked him, do you like to learn Advaita Vedanta from me? Sri Ramakrishna said, I have to go and check with my mother. Ask my mother. If she says yes, I will learn. Totapuri thought, oh, this grown-up man, why should he ask his mother to learn Vedanta? But he didn't. Totapuri did not know what Sri Ramakrishna meant by mother. Then Sri Ramakrishna went to the temple and came back after a few minutes. Yes, my mother told me that you have come to teach me Advaita Vedanta, I will learn from you. That's how true mother was to him. He could converse with her as we are able to talk with each other. Then third aphorism was, Ishvara darshanam sakshatkarascha jivanasya lakshyam. Lakshya means the goal. The ultimate goal of human life is to see God and to realize God, to experience God directly. That's the goal. Other things are, maybe we have so many other things to do in life. I want to buy a property, or somebody wants to marry, somebody has children, somebody wants a promotion. These are approximate short-term goals, but they are not the ultimate goal. They will all fade away. None of them is permanent. The only goal, the only reason why we have been born as human beings, This precious gift of human birth has been given to us for one reason only, and that is to realize our true nature, to see God, to know God. In the that was the third aphorism. Ishvara darshanam sakshatkarascha jivanasya lakshyam. The goal of life is to see God and to realize God, experience God. The fifth aphorism. No, that is the third one. The fourth aphorism is Taddarshanena Sakshatkarena Cha Sarvam Kritam Sarvam Praptam. If we know God, if we realize God, everything will have been achieved. There is nothing else that remains to be achieved. Highest achievement is God realization. That Upanishad says, Brahmavid Apnoti Param. A knower of Brahman, the knower of God reaches the highest. There is nothing higher than that. There is no other goal that remains to be achieved after God realizing God. That's the fourth aphorism. Fifth one was the need for a guru. Fifth says, Tadartham guruna bhavitavyam. In order to reach that goal of God realization, we have to have a guru. Most people need a guru. There are only a few exceptions of great people who realized God without having a guru. Probably Buddha was one of them, Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi had one of them. But Sri Ramakrishna himself had four or five gurus, including a woman guru, bravery, brahmani. So guru is necessary. Guru shows the way. And the guru has to be one who has received direct command from God. Anybody and everybody cannot be a guru. Many people can learn scriptures and teach scriptures. But to be a guru, to guide somebody, help somebody to realize God, one has to have reached that goal himself or herself. Such a person only can be a guru. Sri Ramakrishna said several times, for one to be a guru, one must have received direct command from God. He said, God will appear and tell somebody that you have to teach. Narada, Shukadeva, those people belong to that category of gurus. So that is necessity for a guru and guru's qualifications. Then the sixth aphorism, which we started last time, just began. That is, kama kanchana tyagaha pradhanam sadhanam. Thank you. Thanks. The main practice means to reach that goal of God realization is to relinquish desire for worldly enjoyments. For enjoyment, for property, for possession, for fame, these desires have to be given up. We can't have both. We have to give up. His teaching was this. Sri Ramakrishna's teaching is this one. If you ask me what is one teaching that Sri Ramakrishna emphasized very often, that is this one. Kama kanchana tyagaha pradhanam sadhanam. The main spiritual practice for God realization is relinquishing desires for enjoyment and greed and fame, etc. Then, that's what we are. Maybe began last time, I could not complete it. We'll continue that one. Two more aphorisms are there. Seventh one is satyam cha and truthfulness. In addition to relinquishing desires for enjoyment, worldly fame, pleasures, etc., one should practice truthfulness. Sri Ramakrishna placed great emphasis on the practice of truthfulness. He himself meticulously practiced it. That is the next one, seventh one. The last one, eighth aphorism was Yakulatayeva api Ishvara sakshatkaraha sadhyaha. Or alternately, by intense longing for God. By that alone one can reach God. He himself had so much longing for God. We shall study that one. How he experienced intense longing. He was even willing to give up his life in order to see the Divine Mother. We'll study that later. Now we shall continue with the sixth aphorism, which is kama kanchana tyagaha pradhanam sadhanam. Renunciation of lust and greed is the main discipline. This expression kamini kanchana, kama kanchana comes almost on every page, I can say, in the Gospel. His main teaching, but that is likely to be misunderstood. The literal meaning of kamini is woman. Kanchana means gold. There's nothing wrong with woman and gold. Without them, we cannot live. We need money, resources to lead a life. And without women, world cannot exist. In our shastras, in our scriptures, woman has been praised as the very embodiment of the Divine Mother. In the Chandi, Devi Mahatmam, which many of you know, 11th chapter, there is one verse, sixth verse. There, the Markandeya Rishi, who taught this Devi Mahatmyam, he says, every woman in this world, no matter to which nationality, caste, whatever, every woman, female in this world, is the very embodiment of the Divine Mother herself. Sriya Samasta Sakala Jagatsu. Every woman. So that is how we should regard women, as the Divine Mother herself. Swamiji also taught that one in his inspired talks, which he gave in 1895 summer, July, August, in Thousand Island Park in New York. This was one of his topics. On July 2nd, 1895, Swamiji said, The lecture topic was honoring women, worshipping women as the Divine Mother herself. Anyone who looks upon women as an object of enjoyment is being a grave mistake, grave mistake. Swamiji wrote himself in his famous Song of Sannyasi, "No man who thinks of woman as his wife can ever perfect be." So that is what Sri Ramakrishna taught. Woman is not to be thought of as an object of enjoyment. She is Divine Mother herself. Because of her, the world exists, continues. So, Kamini Kanchana Tyaga should not be understood in a literal way. There is nothing wrong with Kamini or Kanchana. By that, what he meant was lust and greed. Lust for sensory enjoyment. Kanchana means desire for money, wealth, greed for more property. That those two things are the main obstacles to spiritual life. Sri Ramakrishna not only said that we should all give up, those who are seeking God should give up Kamini Kanchana, lust and greed, but he also gave concrete instructions on how to do that one. That's the important part. We'll study that one today. By Kamini Kanchana, he meant lust and greed. His persistent call to renounce lust and greed can be considered to be his main teaching, we can say. Sri Ramakrishna did not hate women. One disciple asked him, "Should we then hate women?" No, he said, "No, no hatred. Worship women." He himself worshipped Sarada Devi, his wife, as the very embodiment of the Divine Mother. He took care of his own mother with so much love during her last years of her life, kept her in the Nahabat and inquired about her well-being every day, made every arrangement for her to be taken care of properly. So did Swamiji, Swami Vivekananda. He went to great lengths to make sure that his mother is very well taken care of during her last years. Other great saints also, like Shankaracharya, they all considered taking care of mother as a very important duty. Whether he is a monk or a householder does not matter. Sri Ramakrishna did not hate women. He looked upon every woman as his own mother. He considered the prostitute Ramani. In that Dakshineswar area, there was a lady, a prostitute. His name was Ramani. She was walking one day in the street. Sri Ramakrishna saw her. And then she saw in her the Divine Mother herself. He could see Divine Mother in all and everything, including a cat, during that vision. So he said, "Oh, Divine Mother, you have chosen to come in this form." Every woman is a Divine Mother herself, whether she be a prostitute or a queen or whatever, any woman. That was how he regarded women. But what he said was, we should give up desire for enjoyment, sensory enjoyment. Same thing applies to women also. Most of the teachings were given when men were there. But to women who came separately, he gave the same teaching. No attachment for men, enjoyment, for a purpose of enjoyment. He worshipped his wife, Sri Sarada Devi, and he kept his mother in the Nahabat and took care of her. His frequent exhortations to renounce lust and greed is in keeping with the teachings of the scriptures, Upanishads mainly. Two things we have to notice while studying the teachings of Sri Ramakrishna. One thing is, whatever he taught was all based on his own direct personal experience, not theoretical knowledge. He did not read many books and repeat them as some people do. We all do that one. His teaching was based on his own experience, everything he taught. Second thing that we have to notice while studying the teachings of Sri Ramakrishna is, whatever he taught was in total conformity with the scriptures, Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita and other scriptures. He never studied any scriptures directly. When he was very young, he used to listen to the discussions of the wandering monks who used to pass through Kamarpukkur during their pilgrimage to Puri and other places. He would listen to their discussions, their study of the scriptures very carefully. And he had a phenomenal memory. Whatever he heard once, that was recorded permanently in his mind. Swamiji also had that phenomenal memory. Once he had to hear one, that's all. It would be that, never be forgotten. So he remembered all the teachings that Sri Ramakrishna heard from the wandering monks. He could quote statements from Adhyatma Ramayana, from Ashtavakra Samhita, from Gita and other scriptures. Why? How? He did not study any of them himself directly. He heard from the monks, they remembered that. Then whatever he taught was exactly in conformity with the teaching of the scriptures, that we can notice every time. So here, when he said, you have lust and greed, Kamani Kanchana, this is what the Upanishads say. In the Kathopanishad, there is a very well-known mantra. I just read the translation. When all desires clinging to one's heart fall off, then a mortal becomes immortal. Man becomes divine and attains Brahman here. Now, here and now, not in some future time after death, no. Everything here and now. Ihaiva. When all the knots of the heart are destroyed, knots, K-N-O-T-S, knots means the things that tie us, bind us and limit us to this plane of physical existence. What are the knots that tie our hearts? Hridaya Granthi, lust, anger, greed, desire for fame, jealousy, pride, all these things. He talked about 8 fetters on several occasions. Those are the knots that tie us up and keep us at this level, prevent us from rising to our inherent divine nature. So when God is realized, when all the knots of the heart are cut asunder, when all the knots of the heart are destroyed, even while a man is alive, here and now and in this life, then a mortal becomes immortal. Man becomes divine. He is already divine, but he realizes his divine nature at that time. This much alone is the instruction of all the Upanishads. That is what Sri Ramakrishna taught. A similar statement occurs in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad also. There we are told, we study, when all the desires that dwell in his heart, that means in a person, seeker's heart, are gone, then he or that person, he or she, having been mortal, becomes immortal and attains Brahman in this very body. That is the emphasis. Sri Ramakrishna's teaching was all here and now. Can be done. He demonstrated and he said, it can be done by anybody. But for some, it takes a little longer. Depends upon where we start, at what point we start our spiritual life and how much we have done before and the pace at which we try. Some people can do much more senior sadhana, serious sadhana and reach the goal quickly. Some people take a little longer, but everybody will reach the goal. Everybody's birthright is God realization because we are that divine. Swamiji famously said, while commenting on Patanjali's yoga aphorism, each soul is potentially divine. The goal is to realize the divinity by any of the yogas. That's the goal. And we are that even now. If you are not that, if you acquire that with effort, it will not be permanent. It is inherent. Only we have to remove the ignorance that covers the divine presence within us. All spiritual practices are only to remove the ignorance, not to bring God into our heart. He's already there, always been there. That is what Sri Ramakrishna taught. Then, what prevents us from knowing our divine nature? If you are divine, we should know it now, experience it now. If God is within me, I should be able to see Him and experience His presence now. What is preventing me from doing that? Desires. desire is an affliction. A desire means a feeling of emptiness. I don't have something, and if I get something, I'll be happy. It may be an object, experience, it may be anything. That's a state of incompletion. There's a gap. We are not experiencing our perfect, pristine nature, which is truly our nature. Inherently, we are that. So the obstruction is the ignorance. Maya, avidya, you can call it in any different way, give us different explanation, but it's something is preventing us. What is it that preventing us from knowing God? Now, Brahadaranyaka Upanishad says, there are three kinds of desires. All desires are only one, feeling of incompletion, feeling of being incomplete, not perfect. The three desires that the Upanishad says are, first one is putraishana. Eshana means desire. Putraishana means desire for a progeny, children, grandchildren. Very strong desire in human beings. Animals also have that one. The animals take care of their babies, children, with great love and determination. If you go near a mother lion or any animal or a dog or anything, it will fiercely protect its child. That inherent feeling, love, or desire to have a progeny, that means it's a desire covered in a different way, veiled, desire for immortality, but expressed as desire for children, grandchildren, continuation of the family tradition. So that is one desire. First one that prevents us from realizing our divine nature here and now. The second desire the Upanishad talks about is vittaishana. Vitta means money. Vittam means money. Money or anything that money can buy, property, etc. So that is a strong desire. I want to have something. I don't have this. I want to have more. I don't have enough. I want to have more. I don't have it. I want to have it. Then I'll be complete. That feeling of incompletion will go when I obtain something which I don't have, which I want to have. Temporarily. But that's not the real fulfillment. All the desires are actually desires to know our true nature, but veiled. The desire to have a child or a property or money or a big position or fame or whatever is nothing but desire to know our perfect nature. We are seeking perfection. We are seeking completion. But in our own limited way. So, vittaishana, desire for money, property, etc. The third desire is lokaishana. Loka means this world or any other world. Enjoyment for seeking happiness in this world. And in other world, heaven also. People like to go to heaven. They do various ceremonies to go to heaven, hoping that it will bring happiness. Heaven is also same as the earth. Only thing is we are expending our good deeds, punya karma. As long as our good deeds, punya karma, stock of karma lasts, so long we stay in heaven. And the moment our punya is exhausted, that very moment we come back down to human plane. This Sri Krishna explains in the Gita 9th chapter. He says, Kshene punye martyalokam vishanti. I gave the example of heaven, just like going on a cruise. It depends upon how much money you want to spend. If you want only a 2-day weekend cruise, you get it for a couple of $1,000 maybe. I don't know how much it costs now. And after that, you have to come back and you have to get off the ship. If you spend more money, maybe $7,000-$8,000 or something, can go for a week-long trip, a longer cruise. You can go to European ports also, do all the shopping and enjoyment and everything. But after all of that, no matter how long the cruise is, it ends. And you have to come back and get off the plane, get off the ship where you got on in the first place. Heaven is also like that, not a permanent place. So seekers of God don't hanker for heavenly enjoyment. Yamutra phalabhoga viragaha, Shankaracharya says in the Viveka Chodhamani. Vairagya renunciation means, in this world, in this life, amutra, in the next life, in heaven, phalabhoga viragaha, giving up desire for enjoyment here in the life hereafter, on earth and in heaven or any other place. That is location, desire for heaven, for enjoyment in this world and any other world. This is very temporary enjoyment, it will go away. These desires are the same as what Sri Ramakrishna calls in his own way, Kamini Kansana. When he uses the expression Kamini Kansana, it means all kinds of desires. Principally desire for enjoyment and wealth. But he expresses the term Kamini Kansana because that is the expression that people used to use in those days, Kamini Kansana. So that was the main teaching. Now the next question is, why we should give up Kamini Kansana? Why not we enjoy, have a good time in this life? Sri Ramakrishna explains that one. That's the main obstruction to spiritual life to realize God. Lust and greed are the main obstructions to God vision, Sri Ramakrishna said. Sri Ramakrishna did not blame women for man's fall from spiritual path. It is man's looking upon woman as an object of pleasure that poses the obstruction in spiritual life. To Captain Vishwanath, Sri Ramakrishna said this one. But what is there to enjoy in the world? Woman and gold? That is only a momentary pleasure. One moment it exists and the next moment it disappears. All worldly enjoyments, whatever it is, money, property, fame, wealth, pleasure, they're all temporary, short-lived. After some time, they will end. They begin at a certain point in time. They were not there all the time. And they last for some time. And then they end after some time. Leaving us disillusioned and disappointed when they leave. When pleasure comes, you are very happy. We are happy, joyful. And when it leaves, the opposite. Unhappy, disillusion, discontentment will come. This is nicely explained in the Gita by Bhagavan Sri Krishna, succinctly in one verse. The temporary nature and the highly conditional nature of worldly enjoyment. That's the reason why wise people don't seek them. In verse number 22, chapter 5, Sri Krishna says, the highly temporary and conditional nature, undependable nature of worldly enjoyments. There he says, ye hi samsparshaja bhoga dukkhayo naya evate ajyantavanta kaunteya nateshu ramate buddha. Buddha means a wise person, one who has wisdom. Such a wise person who can think deeply and see through things and understand their real nature, such a person does not seek worldly pleasures. Nateshu Ramate does not take any delight in worldly pleasures. Why? Because they are samsparshaja bhoga. Sparsha means touching, contact. All the happiness that we are familiar with, that we seek, are of this nature. Sense organ, mind sense organ, one or more sense organs on one side, a sense object on the other side. When contact is made between these two, then the mind interprets that contact sometimes as happiness, sometimes as unhappiness. Same object can give happiness at one time, same object can give a lot of pain at other time. You can clearly see this in relationships. Food also, sometimes when you are young and energetic and healthy, you can enjoy any kind of food. You can eat anything, pizza, cheesecake, or whatever you want, as much you want, you can eat, enjoy. But what happens after some time? Body problem starts. The very same food that gave us happiness at one time, we cannot even touch it. Doctor says no sugar, no spices. So what happened? Same object, same sense organ. That's the temporary nature, unconditional, undependable nature of sense objects. Happiness coming from sense of samsparshaja bhoga, this kind of happiness which includes everything that we seek in the world, They are dukkha yonaya evate. Dukkha yoni means, yonaya means cause of dukkha. Eventually they create unhappiness, disillusionment, disappointment. When you are experiencing them, you are very happy. You don't think about what happens next moment. When they leave, then we become very unhappy. Same thing. Then second problem with worldly enjoyment is, why Sri Ramakrishna says give up kamini kanchana is, ajyantavantaha, they all have a limited duration. Everything gives happiness for some time only. Before some time, it was not there. It had a beginning. When you are born, we didn't bring any sense object, any pleasure, nothing. There was no family, there was no wife, there were no children. We came alone. And we leave, we'll live alone. In between, we have all these temporary associations. Adi antavanta. They all end at some time, sooner or later. The object, all the objects may be intact. Property, money, car, family, everything is intact. Person is unable to enjoy because of disability, old age. As in the study in the Kathopanishad, Sarvendriyanam Jarayanti Tejaha. If all the objects of pleasure are available, our ability to enjoy the objects of pleasure will diminish and disappear with age. Sense organs lose their acuity to enjoy sense objects. So that end will come one way or the other. Or we may not be there at all. Some objects are there, we may have to leave, lose our ability to enjoy. Or we are there and the objects themselves will disappear. Sometimes, in a moment, everything will go away. This moment a person had a good family, a good job, children, grandchildren, money, everything. Next moment, everything disappears. Shankaracharya says, in his famous Bhajagovinda Stotram, Harati Nimeshat Kalas Sarvam. Nimesha means the time it takes to blink our eyes once. In the twinkling of an eye, a person can lose everything. From rags to riches, from riches to rags. That's the undependable nature of worldly pleasures. That is why Sri Ramakrishna says, try for something which is permanent, inherent, cannot be lost. Why seek after these temporary things? They are here today, next moment they are not there. And they give only unhappiness when they leave. So that is why he frequently emphasized the renunciation of woman and gold. That means desire for pleasures and property, etc. Sri Ramakrishna said to Pratap Mazumdar, it is woman and gold that keeps men away from God. Men and women are same. That is the barrier. On another occasion, Sri Ramakrishna said, woman and gold is the cause of bondage. He treats them as one, kamini kanchana. Though there are two things, all desires are only one desire. Woman and gold alone constitutes samsara, the world. Samsara means the cycle of birth and death, transmigration. You keep on enjoying same thing, not fulfillment, again death will come, again you will born again, same desires will come. This has been going on for a long time. You don't remember any of those. Fortunately, we don't remember. If you remember, it will be a terrible experience. You can't bear that one. That is why it is temporary in nature. It is woman and gold that keeps one from seeing God. Holding the towel in front of his face, he took a towel and kept it in front of his face. People were sitting there, disciples were sitting there. Do you see my face anymore? Of course not. The towel hides it. No sooner is the covering of woman and gold removed than one attains Chidananda, consciousness and bliss. Main obstruction to spiritual life to God realization is all our desires. He calls it woman and gold. Any desire is the same thing. Any desire is an affliction. So we should only seek God, the only source of permanent, lasting, infinite, eternal bliss. Nothing else can give that one in this world. That's the basis for practice of renunciation. Then he said, let me tell you something. He who has renounced the pleasure of a wife has verily renounced the pleasure of the world. God is very near to such a person. Swamiji Vivekananda said the same thing in a telling way in his Song of Sannyasin, which he composed in 1895, one stanza is this one. Truth never comes where lust and fame and greed reside, greed of gain reside. No man who thinks of woman as his wife can ever perfect be. How much more directly can it be said? No man who thinks of woman as his wife can ever perfect be. Same thing applies to women also. The teaching was mostly for men, because men were present most of the time. Nor he who owns the least of things, nor he whom anger chains, can ever pass through Maya's gates. So give this up, sannyasin bold, say, Om, Tatsat, dust and greed. So Sri Ramakrishna called it Kamani Kanchana. Swamiji says directly, no one who owns the least of things, ownership, I own this, my property, it's my money, I want more money, great obstruction to spiritual life. Nor he who whom anger chains, anger, can ever pass through Maya's gates. Permanently will be stuck in the realm of Maya if you don't give up these things. So give this up, sannyasin bold, say Om Tat Sat Om. Swamiji's Song of Sannyasi. In the Gita also, these same things come again and again. I like to point out one shloka in the 16th chapter. There Bhagavan Sri Krishna says, there are three main gateways to suffering. Three main gateways to suffering. They are lust and greed and anger. These three are main obstructions. Others also, but these are the main three obstructions. In the 16th chapter, there is a verse 21 where Bhagavan says, Trividham narakasyedam dwaram nashanam atmanah. Narakasya trividham dwaram. Naraka is a place of suffering. Here also naraka is there. You don't have to go to any other realm of existence for naraka. Narakasya means suffering. Three gateways are there. Three main obstructions to God realization. They are kamaha, krodaha, tatha, lobha. Kama means lust. Desire for anything is lust. Krodha means anger. Lobha means greed. Greed can kill a person. Some time ago, I gave a Sunday talk on Tolstoy, Count Leo Tolstoy's one famous short story. The title of the story is How Much Land a Man Needs. The story of a farmer, a long story. A farmer had greed for more. He already had some land inherited from his parents. He could have been happy and content with that one. He could already have happy land, no more land. He went to extreme lengths to acquire more and more and more land. No matter how much land he acquired, sacrificing everything, he was not content. Greed. Actually, in that effort to gain more land, he died. Greed killed him, literally. Very fantastic story. Tolstoy story. So greed is a great enemy in spiritual life. Greed for anything. So Sri Krishna says in the same verse, Tasmad etatrayam tyajet. Therefore, these three things are to be given up. This is what Sri Ramakrishna said, Kamani Kanchana, he said in a succinct, in his own way. All greed, all desire, all anger, these things, they are the main obstructions to spiritual life. Now comes the important part in Sri Ramakrishna's teaching. How to overcome lust and greed. That's what we want to know. There are five things that I could glean from the gospel that Sri Ramakrishna said, practical things that we can do to give up lust and greed. Sri Ramakrishna suggested several means of overcoming lust and greed. First means, Sri Ramakrishna said, by repeating God's name. A devotee asked a question, Sri Ramakrishna, how can I develop love for God? That was the question. The reply Sri Ramakrishna gave was, repeat his name and sins will disappear. Thus you will destroy lust, anger, the desire for creature comforts and so on. Simplest technique. Everybody can do it. You don't need any special qualifications except desire to do that one. Willingness must be there. Repeating God's name. Any name of God is okay. Sri Ramakrishna said, Durga, Rama, Krishna, Shiva, your own chosen ideal. All names are names of one God only. And every name of God has the same infinite power in it. Infinite power of God embedded in every name. The more we repeat God's name, easier it will become for us to give up the defect, lust and greed and other defects. That's what other disciples also said. Swami Adbhutananda, Lata Maharaj, somebody asked him, sir, I have this problem of desire, lust and greed, etc. Then Lata Maharaj gave a simple answer, simple technique, nothing complicated. He said, look at the picture of Sri Ramakrishna and repeat his name. That will take care of all the problems, lust and greed, everything will go away. But you have to be sincere. Look at the picture of Sri Ramakrishna, repeat his name. No other requirement is there. Sincerity must be there. Desire must be there to give up lust and greed. That desire is important desire. Desire to give up all other desires on lust and greed, that desire only we should have. That is one first instruction, repeating God's name to overcome lust and greed. Second instruction, Sri Ramakrishna said, by prayer. Several times, Sri Ramakrishna prayed to the Divine Mother only for pure devotion, not for anything else. He prayed to show to his disciples how to pray for only pure devotion. He said, he gave this prayer not for himself, but to tell others, teach others how to pray to God and what we should ask of God when we pray to God. This is the prayer from the Gospel. This is on page 731. Very interesting, important passage. Sri Ramakrishna, O Mother, I throw myself on thy mercy. I take shelter at thy hallowed feet. I do not want bodily comforts. I do not crave name and fame. Ma amir tomar padapadde shrana nilam dehasuka chayana ma lokamana chayana animadi ashtasiddhi chayana. That famous prayer. I do not seek the eight occult powers. Be gracious and grant that I may have pure love for thee, a love unsmitten by any selfish ends, a love craved by the devotee for the sake of love alone. And grant me the favor, O Mother, that I may not be deluded by thy world-bewitching maya, that I may never be attached to the world, to woman and gold, conjured up by the inscrutable maya. O Mother, there is no one but thee whom I may call my own. Mother, I do not know how to worship. I am without austerity. I have neither devotion nor knowledge. Be gracious, Mother, and out of thy infinite mercy, grant me love for thy lotus feet. The only thing we should ask of God is love for God. Other things like money, fame, etc., property, possessions, these are not worth asking. They are very temporary, even if they are given to us. This prayer reminds us of very similar prayers for pure devotion by other teachers of devotion, like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Narada Maharshi, and Tulsidas. They all prayed only for pure devotion. They set an example when we pray to God what we should ask of God. Not money, not wealth, not fame, nothing. Only devotion, pure devotion. In the Tulsi Ramayana, We had Ramnam last night. Many of you were here. There's a very famous prayer which we repeat during our Ramnam Sankirtan. There, Tulsidas prays only for pure devotion. Nanya spreha Raghupate Hridaye smadiye Satyam vadami cha bhavan Akhilantaratma Bhaktim prayachha Raghupungava Nirbharami Kamadidosharahitam Kurumanasam cha. Very nice, very important prayer. Tulsidas, O Lord Sri Ramachandra, you are the innermost self of all. I tell you the truth. I do not have any worldly desire in my heart. Please grant me intense devotion to you. Please also free my mind from lust and other impurities. Kamadi dosharaitam mama manasam. Why I am reading this, what Sri Ramakrishna taught, pray to God for pure devotion, not for anything else. It's an old, it's nothing new. Other great saints, teachers have given the same instruction. All the instructions that Sri Ramakrishna gave are in total conformity with the instruction that we read in other scriptures, Upanishads, Gita and other scriptures. The Mother Kunti, the Pandava's mother, she prayed, Ya Preeti Ravivekinam Vishayeshwanapayini Tamanusmarata Swami Hradayan Mapasarpatu. May I think of thee, O Lord, with that strong love which the ignorant cherish for the things of the world. May that pure devotion love never cease to abide in my heart. So when we pray to God, we should not seek worldly things. Long life, good health, beauty, power, position, fame, family. Seek only pure devotion to God. And finally, one more example. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu composed this famous Shikshashtakam. 8 stanzas on prayer. How to pray to God and what we should seek from God. Nadanam, najanam, nasundarim, kavitam, va jagadisha kamaye, mama janmani janmani ishvare bhavata bhakti rahituki twai. O Lord, Lord of the universe, Jagadisha, I am not seeking wealth, dhanam. I am not seeking followers, disciples, janam. Nasundarim kamaye, I am not seeking a beautiful, good-looking spouse. I want one thing from you. Mama janmani janmani. In all my births, in this birth, and if we have to take more births in the future, in all the future births also, Tvayi Ishvare Ahaitaki Bhakti Bhavata. May I have only pure devotion to you, O Lord. That's the prayer that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said. Third thing. First thing is repetition of God's name. Second thing is prayer. Third means to overcome lust and greed by diverting all passions towards God. A Brahmo devotee asked Sri Ramakrishna once this question. We have passions like anger and lust. What shall we do with these? Good question. Asked by a Brahmo devotee. Sri Ramakrishna replied this. Direct the 6 passions to God. The impulse of lust should be turned into the desire to have union with Atman. Feel angry at those who stand in your way of God. If you have to be angry at those who cause obstruction in your spiritual life. Feel greedy for Him. If you must have the feeling of I and mine, then associate it with God. Instead of saying this property is mine, this child is mine, this house is mine, this work is mine, say God is mine. Feeling of I and mine. Associate it with God. Say, for instance, my Rama, my Krishna. If you must have pride, then feel like Vibhishana, who said, I have touched the feet of Rama with my head, I will not bow this head before anyone else. If you have to have pride, let us have pride in being devotee of God. Third instruction. Fourth instruction on how to give up lust and greed by practicing discrimination, Viveka. This is a very big topic. Well, Viveka Chodamani, which Swamiji taught, is all on Viveka only. What is real and what is unreal, what is lasting, permanent, what is temporary. That Viveka. Sri Ramakrishna emphasized that one. Some teachers of bhakti, like Prahlada and Narada, they did not say much about Viveka. Practice of bhakti, they explained. But Sri Ramakrishna, he included Viveka in all the, every time he talked about devotion to God, he also said, practice Viveka, discrimination between real and unreal. He said, and you should always discriminate between the real and the unreal. God alone is real, the eternal substance. All else is unreal, that is impermanent. By discriminating thus, one should check off impermanent objects from the mind. Another day he said, you must practice discrimination. Woman and gold is impermanent. What is impermanent? Not dependable, temporary, goes away, causing unhappiness. Give that up. God is the only eternal substance. What does a man get with money, food, clothes, and a dwelling place? Nothing more. You cannot realize God with money. Therefore, money can never be the goal of life. That is the process of discrimination. Consider what is there in money or in a beautiful body. Why should a man give up God and direct his attention to such things? Why should a man forget God for their sake? Fifth instruction on how to give up lust and greed. By cultivating holy company and praying in solitude. Mahendranath Gupta asked question, sir, how may we fix our minds on God? During the second meeting, this was one of the four questions M asked. Sri Ramakrishna's reply was, repeat God's name and sing his glories and keep holy company and now and then visit God's devotees and holy people, holy men, holy people. Another day he said, whenever you have leisure, go into solitude for a day or two. At that time, don't have any relations with the outside world and don't hold any conversation with worldly people and on worldly affairs. You must live either in solitude or in the company of holy men, holy people. One more instruction. One should keep pictures of holy men in one's room. That constantly quickens divine ideas. It is true that one's spiritual feelings are awakened by looking at the picture of a sadhu. Therefore, I tell you that you should constantly live in the company of holy men. One finds peace of mind in the company of holy men. The alligator remains underwater for a long time, but every now and then it rises to the surface and breathes with a deep wheezing noise. Then it gives a sigh of relief. One more instruction, Sri Ramakrishna, it is necessary for him, he means the householder, seeker of God, it's necessary for him constantly to live in the company of holy men. When he gets back his own mind, then he can devote it to spiritual practice. But first it is necessary to live constantly with the Guru, wait on him and enjoy the company of spiritual people. Either he should think of God in solitude day and night, or he should live with holy people. So these are the five practical ways in which Sri Ramakrishna said we can give up lust and greed, desire for enjoyment. So we will stop here. Next instruction, seventh instruction is practice of truthfulness that we shall study next time when we get an opportunity. Thank you all for coming. I shall say the closing prayer and Swamiji will conclude the proceedings. Om Sarve Bhavanta Sukhinaha, Sarve Santu Niramayaha, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhavet. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om, may all be happy, may all be free from afflictions, may all realize what is noble and auspicious, may there be harmony and no ill will among all the beings, may no one be subject to misery. Om peace, may there be peace and joy in our hearts, Adhyatmika Shanti, may there be peace and harmony amongst all beings, Adi Bhavatika Shanti, may there be peace everywhere in nature, Adi Daivika Shanti. Hari Om Tat Sat Sarvam Sri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu.
Two main announcements. One is next Sunday we'll be observing our Durga Puja. It will be available by live streaming, as all of our Sundays have been, but also those who are fully vaccinated and have been practicing safe things, not mixing with anybody who's been sick, are welcome to come also. We won't be able to serve prasad to everyone in the basement as we usually do, but we'll have packets. Everyone will get prasad, those who come here also. So those of you who would like to come are welcome to come. Otherwise, you'll be able to see it on the on your computer screen. The other thing is every year we do this repetition of the mantra Jai Sri Durga, or some do their own mantra. And Swami Sarvedanandji, he sent me something to read to everyone. So, my loving greetings and best wishes for you all. Following the inspiration and footsteps of revered Swami Swahanandaji Maharaj, we invite and encourage the devotees everywhere to pledge for repeating Jai Sri Durga, Japa, or chanting the mantra given by your guru during this coming auspicious Navaratri period, from Mahalaya to Vijaya Dashami. That means it starts on Wednesday, 6th October, and it goes to Friday, 15th October. He says, as we did in past years. The idea is to pledge a certain amount of a japa, repetition of the mantra, for each day over and above one's regular number. And also, this is not something while you're driving in the car and everything. It means taking a little extra time and sitting and doing a japa. This has at least two benefits. One, it helps us to stretch ourselves to have a greater capacity for spiritual practice. And two, the spiritual energy produced and the merit that it brings for each 100,000 repetitions is equal to one grand Durga Puja performance. Though it is best to be consistent to do japa every day as far as possible, yet if one gets behind the number pledged one day, one can make up that difference in the next days. Counting may be done by using a mala, or by tally counter that some people do on their fingers, or by observing how long it takes to do 1,000. Therefore, thereby one does not have to focus on the counting, but can know the number by watching the time only. Yeah, if we do it one time, we pledge a certain amount, we do it one time, we see it took a half hour, then if we want, we don't have to count. And then he says, please announce this during your... So that's for me. Okay, we have a sign-up sheet. And for those who are watching this via live streaming, if you send an email to the sender, we'll write down your name and the number. The sign-up sheet has the number of chants per day and then the total. If you're really confident that you'll fulfill the pledge, you can do both. Otherwise, you can just put your what you're pledging for each day, and then at the end tell us what the total was. We assume everyone will do the whole thing. So for those of you who are here now, I'll leave it outside, and whoever wants to can sign up now. Otherwise, you can send an email. Okay, thank you. And thank you all for coming.